welcome back. It's been a bit since my last update on the Turbo Micra, but believe me, I've been working on this thing constantly since my last upload. I have hours and hours of video covering various jobs being ticked off the list, but this episode will cover converting the cable clutch system from the Micra into a hydraulic system that will work with the Audi clutch. But before I get started on that, I really wanted to see the front end back together and the car back on its feet. This is partly because I needed to check that everything was still lined up properly, and also because I wanted to see how much sump clearance I actually have to play with. Not to mention seeing it looking like a Micra again being a bit of a morale booster. I don't know about anyone else, but I find it surprisingly easy to get so focused on one part of a project that I lose sight of the bigger picture sometimes, so seeing the car in one piece back on the ground helps me realign myself with the vision. Anyway, I need to get to the factory clutch pedal, and the easiest way to do that is to get the dashboard out of the way. If anyone has any problems with me putting Volkswagen parts in this car, then I'll draw your attention to this connector, which is fitted from the factory. And I'm not even sure if I'll be keeping it. This vent pipe gave me a lot of hassle, so much so that I had to drop the entire steering column to free it up. Aside from that though, removal of a K11 dashboard is pretty much a nuts and bolts affair, and most of it goes back together in one piece so I don't lose anything whilst it's in storage. All that remains is the HVAC system that lurks behind the dashboard. I've left it in place for now as it's not in the way, and I don't want to remove too much now in case I screw myself over with access and clearance for the gear selector cabling later on. You also get to see how the knobs and sliders control the various parts of the HVAC system, using steel cables connected to air flaps. I thought it was pretty interesting. Right, so let's compare the two pedals. We've got the Micras pedal on the left, and we've got the Primera's pedal on the right. Actually, it's from an Almera. And as we can see, that we already know that the stud spacing is exactly the same, because we tested with the master cylinder. The main difference that is obvious here is that because this is supposed to be from a cable clutch, we've got a hook on there, and then this one has a clevis pin. So this is designed to pull a cable, and this is designed to push a cylinder. The biggest difference is this bit at the top. So that would bolt into the bulkhead on whichever car this came from. That is here on the Micra. So it's in a different place. How much that's going to be a problem, I don't know yet. The pedal arms themselves are pretty much the same shape. This one has a bit more of a kink in it, whereas this one sort of kinks at the bottom. So that might just result in the pedal face being in exactly the same place. So what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to pop this one in and see where everything lines up. And I have a feeling this top part here is going to have to be cut out. Let's see what gets in the way. I'll get the angle grinder out if I have to. Pedal is in. So the spacing wise, from left to right, it doesn't look too bad. It's probably no different from the original pedal. It does sit quite high though. And that's the maximum that it will go down, which is quite a lot further forward than the brake does on its maximum travel. Now this doesn't have a cylinder on the other end of it. And neither does this, so the cylinder might govern how far this moves backwards and forwards. But yeah, I think there's definitely a slight size difference, but I'm going to pull this back out again and just check the spacing. After removing the top part of the bracket there, it does give me a bit more room. Can you see that red bit of paint? That is where the original clutch bracket would attached to, and it is butting right up against that, so there might be a way I can still attach it using the original hardware, but the hole that you can just see there doesn't go to anywhere, so that's pretty much useless. I've measured the depth of those holes, so there's a spacer in there, so I've measured the depth of those and I determined them to be a little under 23 millimeters. So we've got the pedal here with the master cylinder. We take this with the same amount of space. Oh, I've just messed that up. 23 millimeters would put the master cylinder there, which means that there's no threads on the end here for the nut to bite onto. So I'm guessing that on whichever car this came from, there would have been a bigger recess to accommodate these. Let me know what they are. I don't think they're threaded, but they're just spacers. Basically, what I'm dealing with here is a double spacing issue. On the Almira pedal, there's a spacer on each stud, but on the Micra, those spacers are built into the bulkhead, so one of them has to go. Now I have enough thread exposed to keep everything together, but as shown here, one of those studs pokes out more than the other. That's because I'm still colliding with the original upper bulkhead mount. So after cutting the top of the pedal bracket so it's completely flush, everything fits perfectly. I need to re-add that structure later, but in a way that will allow me to use the bulkhead mount. For now, it's relying on those two studs. I'll refit the steering wheel and protect the clock spring and keep everything together. First thing we're going to do is going to pull the clutch out. No, that is the wrong thing I'm going to do. I'm not going to do that. We're going to put the clutch in. And to do that, we need to pull the engine out. This gives us the perfect opportunity to test whether I can now pull the engine out. So you might have noticed that the front cross member is missing. That was a whole other side quest, which I will go into more detail on another time. But long story short, it's no longer there. So the plan is, as you saw from the last episode, two bolts drop down, we undo that one, the rest of it drops down, we rotate the whole assembly out that way, so the gearbox is pointing this way, and then we roll it out the front. So let's see how that goes. Okay, so we drop the engine down and it's pretty much ready to come out, except this is in the way. So the top of the mount here is colliding with this part of the front structure there. I can't move it back any further because we're right up against the bulkhead there. So if the car was a little bit higher off the ground, we would probably be able to just duck it underneath that. Might be able to get it down a little bit lower, but I think these jacks are pretty much bottomed out now. So I can either lift the car up a little bit, or even though I didn't need to use the engine crane to remove the engine from the car, still needed to use the engine crane to support the engine because it doesn't quite sit on the platform evenly enough without the gearbox on. So we've just got it supported by the crane for now until I build a cradle for this. But we're going to get the gearbox off so that we can fit the clutch. Also, I only borrowed that engine crane from an old workmate so that I could lift an engine one weekend. That was 6 years ago now, so I should probably give it back. I would help, but I don't want to.
So what I was thinking was you do bend around here, then go under around there, and yep, bring it down here. And basically follow these lines.
Would it not make sense to just keep going along there and then go down there?
You could, but
that's only just tucked out the way for now. It isn't supposed to come that way. That fuel filter is supposed to bolt to that.
If you want to do that, I think that's going to be fine. It was more just so that it was following.
Oh, I zip tied it. That's why that's stuck there. I did that because it kept flapping around.
I don't have my blade on me either, so.
But yeah, it makes sense to just come along here, along the top there, down in this this little gooch here, and then along here, and then
excuse me,
and then it'll just stick out there, ready to stick a flexi on.
Because I'm doing this in the centre of the pipe as well, so I've got to approximate. So you mean like that?
Yeah.
I mean, it's gonna work, I will grant you that. But it's just gonna be awkward. I need this out the way. Where do you want it to go down there?
Yeah, make it go down on that bit. I think that's probably more reasonable. That way then, if there's any leaks or anything, it's not gonna get caught in that corner bit where it'll rust out.
I'm guessing you're in a done side.
Yeah, or even just like close to the top corner would be fine. Yeah, that'd be all right. And then I could probably run a little clip in that hole there that will keep it in place.
It's going to go for any minute. There we go. Start from this end, working my way backwards, because this one's going to have a long straight on it.
Yeah.
That way, it doesn't matter how much is left over, because I can easily cut that down. Whereas down here, this one has to be correct, because we're going to go almost immediately into a 90. About there. And then...
Oh, that's ideal, that is, yeah.
Do it on the same plane. So about that.
Did you make yourself jump?
I did.
By smacking the pipe on the car then. Until now, I didn't know the difference between SAE and DIN pipe flares, so aside from thread sizing, I didn't really know which fittings to buy. To get things running, we're reclaiming the fitting attached to the Almira Master for now. Right, so I got the wrong ones, basically.
So this is a handheld hydraulic flaring tool. Basically, it's got the two ends. You've got your DIN end on this side, you've got your SAE end on this side, and you've got your various bits for doing both bubble and double flare. So we're going to use the SAE side, because that's what the Almira
Almira N16.
So what we're going to do is going to put that in like so. And we're going to push it all the way. Might have to loosen this a bit so it's flush. And tying it down. So, and then we have a two-step operation to do a double flare. We need to use this end first, and then we follow it up with this end to actually make the bubble flare. So we're going to do this one as the first operation. Yes, so I tried to get you.
Trying to put myself out in the eye with it. This thing's just been floating around my face constantly.
So.
It's quite dark, but you can just about see it pushing it through. So it's. As he's turning that, I didn't know this was hydraulic, but you just told me it's hydraulic in there, isn't it?
Yeah, so the actual screw mechanism and the output are not mechanically linked in the sense that there's not a screw going between the two. But as you turn this, it applies more force and compression onto the forming tool. And once it's bottomed out, you can just release... This is the tool, and you should have the start of a bubble flare.
There we are.
And then we follow that up with the double flare, which is going to turn it into basically a concave end.
Did you put the fitting on?
Right.
Let's do that again.
What's that you got there, mate?
That is the fitting.
Okay.
It doesn't fit. Okay, there we go.
It's not fitting. Yeah. Oh, so the fitting goes on first. Right. Is it the right way around?
So that's why you needed to put flare it first so that we could get that on with the fitting.
Yeah, because the width of the clamp means that if the bend is too close to the clamp, you're not going to be able to do it. So you have to do that bit first.
Yeah. So there you go.
Now it's my turn to have a go. With the clutch solid line in place, the engine can go back in so we can hook it up to the other side. Right, engine is back in. We've now got the clutch and the flywheel and everything ready to go. There's a couple of reasons why we wanted to do the flywheel now. First of which is we want to get the clutch working, and we can't do that without the flywheel. Second of all, the clutch and the flywheel assembly, they do add up to the total weight of the powertrain. So it's a good idea to have those present so we can actually test the load-bearing capabilities of my mounts. And third of all, they were just taking up room on the shelf. If we come down here, here's our pipe. It's just resting in place at the moment. It has been tied in down there by the master. And now all we need to do is just make a line that goes between there and the slave cylinder, which is down here. Normally we would just use a flexi, like a flexible pipe, and that is what we'll be using on the final product. But because I just want to check that the clutch works, I'm going to be doing a temporary hard line that goes from here down to the slave cylinder. Not ideal, but the engine's not running, it's not moving, nothing's moving around. We just want to check that the clutch works, so we'll do that next. Now, anyone in Vag World knows that the slave cylinder on the Mark IV platform uses this push fit type deal. So instead of using like a screw-on connector like the rest of the system uses, there's like a quick disconnect, which is held in place by this clip. You can just see where I'm pointing there. So what I've done is I've bought this. Well, it's made by Epitech, who do a lot of like conversion hardware for various Volkswagen stuff and Audi stuff. So and they also do this. So this will allow me to use a standard M10 thread brake hose, and this will end up going on the end of the flexi. Actually, thinking about it, maybe I can get a flexi with that fitting on the end. I don't know, we'll think about that. Anyway, this will allow us to plug straight into there, standard M10 thread on the end, and then we'll be able to make our flexi line.
Looks like the perfect size to me.
Yeah. It's not pretty, but it works.
There's no way I could have known that at the time. First, we needed to fill the system and attempt a gravity bleed.
Come on, bleed. So we've had a go with trying to gravity bleed the system and then bleed it like you would normally bleed it. But the pedal seems to just stick to the floor no matter what. It's almost as if it's just not pushing any fluid. And that might just be because the master cylinder is completely dry. So even though we've got fluid up here, it's not really making its way into the cylinder properly. Did you say it actually made its way down there though?
No. So because it's dry enough that up here, I think what's happening is it's not actually coming into the pipe. You can definitely hear, if you loosen this this joint and you listen to it as you're pumping, you can definitely hear like bubbling.
Yeah.
But it's not coming through. So some gearboxes, not saying necessarily this one, some gearboxes or slave cylinders have a different bleeding method. I know that on Ford Mondeos, for example, the Mark III's, Ford officially recommends that you basically inject brake fluid or clutch fluid into the slave cylinder and bleed the system backwards. They have a special tool to do this. So I don't usually like doing this if I don't have to, but seeing as that we're not getting any pumping action going through, we're going to try to reverse bleed it to see if that will help to actually properly bleed it.
Cool, right, let's do that.
Fluid from the cylinder, because hopefully it should come straight back up into the cylinder. I want to get rid of that bubble if I can. Right, I want to open that. Okay, that's opened. So this is what I mean. We should be seeing dripping, but there's nothing. So I'm going to put this in, but I'm going to... Now, I know there's going to be an air bubble that gets put in here, but there's nothing I can do about that. That feels... There's a blockage. So what's going on here is I can't push this in. And because fluid is incompressible, that means that... So we feel like there's a blockage in the system, because when we try to reverse bleed it, this plunger doesn't want to go down. In fact, the pipe came off and sprayed us. So I tried to loosen up this union and that didn't help. So what I'm going to do is loosen up the nut over here. Now, if I loosen this nut up and the fluid starts coming out and starts draining out, then we know that there's a blockage in this pipe somewhere. It could be a kinked pipe or it could just be something else. If it doesn't, it possibly means that there's a blockage within inside of the master cylinder. So I've just loosened that union. I'm not seeing anything dripping out. No, it could just be because it's trying to bleed out all the air first. But it probably means that there's a kink or a blockage within that pipe.
So if you were to push that plunger now, would...
It should, in theory, come out of there.
So we'll know then, won't we, if that's the case?
Yeah, so let's try that. Yeah, actually, it's not. In fact, yeah, so you see here, it's springing back.
Yeah, so I reckon then it's my crappy intermediary one then.
Or there's possibly something in here.
Right, so after a little bit of troubleshooting, the clutch is finally bled and working. So, why don't you explain what happened and why we couldn't get it to work? So what was happening first of all was that we were... if you remember when I fit the pedal, it would just want to stick to the floor. And that's because there's no fluid in the cylinder, so that's just its natural resting position. So when you put fluid in there, that should push it back up. So that was happening no matter what, even when we had fluid in the system. So what was going on with this then?
Right, so this is the spare bleeder valve that's missing its nipple. And what we think...
We can't say nipple on YouTube.
Can you? Is he serious?
I don't know.
It is a bleed nipple. It is a proper term.
Yeah, but it's anatomy.
So this is the bleeder screw from the other slave cylinder that we have. It's missing its end here. What we think was happening is that there might have been some dirt or something that was clogged on the inside of there.
I removed this screw entirely from here, and we basically tried to do a pressure test, and whatever was stuck in there is no longer stuck in there because brake fluid came squirting out.
Yep, so you didn't need to do a reverse bleed or anything.
No, so
this time,
what we ended up having to do was loosen the bleed screw by quite a lot, because I guess the way that this system works, that you need a big amount of gap when you've got a lot of air in the system. When we started seeing some brake fluid coming through, however, we only needed to do like a quarter turn or back.
Yeah, which is what you'd normally expect to do when you're bleeding brakes and the like. So this is working. I don't really know how I can demonstrate it. Hold on. So before, the pedal was just on the floor, right? So imagine it like that. It would just stay like that on the floor. So now when I push it, it stays down and it returns. There is still a slight problem, but it's nothing to do with the hydraulic system, and it's to do with the way this pedal is mechanically attached. So if you look at the top here, see that sort of rusty bracket that's attached there? That wants to move, look, you can see it moving. And that's just because there's an attachment point missing. The bit that attaches up here is different. So I had to cut that off so that it would clear, and I just need to weld that back on. That will give it its 3 points of attachment and the pedal will feel solid again. So that will just remove that issue. But it works. So I am pretty happy with that.
I owe a massive thanks to Naoki for his help with this, and also for showing me how to use his pipe flaring tool. Bleeding brakes and clutches is often a two-person task anyway, but having someone around with industry experience is really handy when things don't go to plan. He runs his own channel that covers his passion for retro gaming and everything that makes it work. If that's up your street, then definitely consider checking out his channel. Back over here, I have some more progress lined up, so get subscribed if you want to get notified when new videos go up. It's not a huge deal to me, but I'd love to break 1,000 subs before the end of the year if possible. Follow me on Instagram, cg10.uk, for photos of progress a bit closer to when it happens, and I will catch you in the next one.